Firstly, thanking Peter for putting together this session. And I will talk about our project on building infrastructure for biological network databases. And this is a collaborative project between Purdue, Case Western Reserve, and the University of California, San Diego. As you can see, we have many people working on this project. And I will highlight parts of what everybody did, what everybody is doing also. So I will start actually by motivating what we are trying to do and really trying to explain what we are trying to achieve, and then talk about something in development, our software development efforts, and then I will talk about the algorithm development that we are doing to support that software development, the algorithmic infrastructure that will support that software development, and then I will give an example of the applications of these algorithms, how they can be used to improve biological knowledge generation. So biological network databases are out there. They have been out there for 20 years now. And when I talk about network databases, I am talking about something quite general. From physical interactions between proteins to regulatory interactions to functional associations, functional and statistical interactions, and also things like phenotype associations, ortology between different organisms, and things like that. And we usually integrate these network data with molecular data so that we can get the best out of the molecular data, but also we use the molecular data to infer the networks. So the molecular data is there waiting for us to integrate with all this network data. And we have been integrating network data with each other and also integrating with molecular data to generate knowledge, again, for more than a decade now. So examples include, for example, disease gene networks, right? You take disease associations, you take protein interactions, and then you use that to construct disease gene networks and to propagate information. Similarly, you take phenotype associations and ortology between different species, you put them together and you make inferences on the relationships between phenotypes of different organisms. Last year we published a paper integrating mutation and differential expression data in the context of cancers by using protein interactions to extract information that you can't otherwise capture using molecular data alone. And similarly, Shahin Mohammadi, who is here today, uses gene expression, tissue-specific gene expression data, maps them on the protein network to identify tissue-specific protein networks by using optimization algorithms. So this has been done, but this has always been done by pulling the network data, pulling the molecular data, downloading them in bulk, and then processing them in-house using sophisticated algorithms to do what we are trying to do. The biological network databases do not provide complex queries. They don't provide us with the opportunity to integrate, to query the database in an integrated way, as we see in these examples. They just provide very simple query interfaces, and even usually we can't really query biological network databases based on topological queries. And what I will come to what I mean by topological querying. So essentially, this brings us to what we are trying to achieve. We are trying to build a graph database software where the algorithms, the query processing, the storage will scale to millions of nodes and edges. If you take a protein interaction network, if you take the human protein interaction network, we are talking about 10,000s of nodes and 100,000s of edges. It doesn't look that big, right? But if you integrate the networks of different organisms, obviously people have done that to make inferences on, for example, functional ortology, then the scale of the data immediately becomes in the order of millions, and then you have to manage that, and really we don't have the algorithmic infrastructure, especially the support for that in the network databases today. Second, there are many different versions of these networks. They are continuously updated, and we don't have version control systems for networks. And third, they represent dynamic systems. Again, to get insights into the dynamics of these networks, we integrate them with molecular data, and the network databases do not have support for this either, for the dynamic analysis. So the question that we are trying to answer is, can we build a scalable graph database system to enable version control, integrated querying, and dynamic analysis? And when we were looking into this, you know, the first idea that we came up with is, well, there are graph database systems out there which are designed to scale for very, very large graphs. So we can use them and we can build the support for biological networks on top of these. We looked at Neo4j, we looked at Titan. Titan is a distributed graph database system which is quite scalable. And we identified many issues with them. One of them is, for example, they don't really provide scalable visualization. They don't support dynamic graphs except for Neo4j, which has partial support for dynamic graphs. They don't have a rich collection of built-in algorithms, right? They are still for simple topological queries, but the biggest problem is Neo4j is commercial. Titan was not, it is just bought, it's still free software, but we are expecting that it will come out to be commercial. So essentially we decided to build our own system that will assess all these properties. So we call the system Treno, and I think I just switched these slides when I was working on the presentation apparently, so which will leverage an existing infrastructure. For example, for computation, there are graph algorithms, algorithmic infrastructure that implement algorithmic infrastructure like GraphX and NetworkX. So for computation, we can use them. For visualization, Cytoscape is out there, has been used very successfully, right? And then for storage, Cassandra is out there. So how can we leverage all these so that we can replace the current workflow, which again is based on downloading the data in bulk, applying the algorithms, and then getting the results and visualizing, replace it with a workflow where you store the networks, you pre-process them and store them, and then you do the computations, visualization, and interaction all together in a cycle where people who are not very literate in computing can also use these sophisticated computational algorithms. So the architecture is based on a combination of SILADB, which is used for storage, Spark, which is used for distributed processing, SOAR, which is used for indexing, and then the Treno core is implemented on top of them, and it interacts with already existing graph database, graph querying language, TinkerPub, with a web console, which we are developing, and also machine learning algorithms, like machine learning frameworks like TensorFlow. So obviously, you know, again, as I said, this is work in progress. We have been developing this, but we are still at the beginning. So I have presented this so that to ask for input, because we would like this to respond to the community's needs. So, but now I want to use the remaining time to give you a more solid example of how we are supporting this system with algorithms that are theoretically grounded. So I will talk about a very specific problem, network proximity queries. I am sure many of the audience today is familiar with this problem. So the idea is, given a node in the network, you are given a network, so again, this can be a protein interaction network, and you are given a protein, and you want to identify the top K, K being a variable signifying the scope of how you want to go, where you want to go, the top K most proximate nodes to that node, right? And for this problem has many applications in biology, right? We use this in disease gene prioritization. We use this in identification of frequently mutated pathways. We use this in integration of different types of omic data. I gave examples of this before. And we have used this for functional annotation. And also, especially in the context of biological applications, we have seen again and again that flow-based proximity measures are much more powerful in achieving this job as compared to simple approaches like looking at the direct interacting partners, the direct neighbors, or shortest paths, because they account for multiplicity of paths and the length of the paths at the same time. And there are lots of flow-based algorithms, random walk with restarts, network propagation, network diffusion, diffusion state distance. Actually, I was at a great workshop, network biology workshop, at the Simons Institute for Theory of Computing in April, and it was a 5-day workshop with about, I think, 40, 50 attendees who are working on network biology. And it was incredible that most of the presentations were somehow using one of these algorithms to analyze the networks. So this is an important problem. And I will give one example, the random walk with restarts algorithm, because it has this nice definition, and it can be computed iteratively, which gives us the opportunity to illustrate how we can improve the computation time. So the random walk with restart space proximity is defined as a mutually reinforcing relationship where you have two components essentially. One is the damping component that drives the random walk to the query node, and then the other term is the network component. So you can compute random walk with restart based proximity iteratively. You start from a zero vector, and then you keep multiplying that vector with the stochastic matrix that is it's derived from the adjacency matrix of the network, and then damping it with the query node again and again. So, but if you are just interested in finding the most proximate nodes, right, if you have millions of nodes, and if you are just interested in finding the top 50, top 100 nodes that are most proximate to your query node, then computing all the entire proximity vector is worthless. And this is an expensive algorithm, obviously. You iteratively multiply a large matrix with a vector. So this has gained a lot of attention in the data mining community in recent years, and people developed algorithms to address top K proximity queries, and these algorithms mostly exploit two things: either the convergence properties of iterative computation, so that you can figure out when to stop if it is not necessary to go any further than you stop the iterations, and second, they also exploit the structural properties of the network, because obviously there is a close relationship between random walk with proximity and, for example, breadth first order. We took a very different approach by looking at the established literature in numerical linear algebra. In numerical linear algebra, iterative algorithms have been used for a long time to solve linear systems. And one way of accelerating this type of iterative solutions is, instead of using the iterate itself, the X here, use a linear combination of all iterates that you have computed so far. So in the context of random walks, for example, the random walker keeps going, and you define your random walk-based proximity as the probability, as the likelihood of being at a given node at infinity. So you want to go to the future, but actually as you go to the future, what you are doing is you are also coming back to past. So if you use the information that you have collected from the previous steps, then you can see what will happen in the future more quickly. So again, instead of looking at the first, the main iterate, look at a linear combination of all the values of the iterate that you have computed so far. Now the problem is, how do we integrate them? How do we aggregate those iterates? So the problem is that you want to select the coefficients in such a way that you can integrate the previous iterates, and the result is established for that. Chebyshev polynomials are the answer to this question. You can formulate this as an optimization problem, and then you can prove that Chebyshev polynomials optimize the convergence, where we define convergence in terms of minimizing the residue between the, again, the iterate that is the linear combination of the previous iterates and the actual value that we are trying to compute. And then using Chebyshev polynomials, you can also show that you can bound the residue quite effectively. Here the bound is exponential in mu, and mu is a function of the restart probability, and which is less than the restart probability, so this always converges faster than the actual iterative algorithm itself. So using this, how can we improve top k proximity queries? Well, since we are given a bound on the residue, we can prove that if we are interested, say, in finding the top 100 most proximate nodes, then at each step we can compute the value for each node to the 100 top node there, and we can show that if the difference is more than 4 times mu to the t, then we can drop that node. That node can't go into the top 100 anymore. Second, I defined the iterate of interest as a linear combination of all iterates. So as we go further in the iterations, this seems to become more and more expensive to compute, but actually not. Since Chebyshev polynomials are defined recursively, we can just compute these iterates by looking at the last two iterates only. So we implemented this algorithm, and this was just accepted for publication in the ACM's data mining conference, KDD. Mustafa Coşkun will present it in August there, but I had the privilege of presenting it before him and spoiling it. So when we look at the results, this is essentially the residual as a function of the number of iterations. Blue is standard power iteration, red is when you use Chebyshev polynomials. Essentially, you accelerate quite further, especially if the restart probability is lower. By the way, we here used networks from the Stanford network database. These are not biological networks for the purpose of illustration on very large networks. And then second, when you look at the top K performance on top K proximity queries as a function of K, again, what you see is the algorithms that use, even the green line represents here an algorithm that uses the structure of the network. Without even using the structure of the network, we can do much better, especially for larger K, than the algorithm that uses the structure of the network. So I also wanted to talk about the application, but I am out of time, so I will just use half a minute to show the application. This is very recent work. So essentially, how can we use all these, for example, for drug response prediction? We construct heterogeneous networks where we represent, we integrate mutations in cell lines, response to drugs for cell lines. So we have edges between drugs and cell lines and genes representing mutations. And then we integrate them with protein interaction networks. We use these proximity algorithms to construct network profiles for cell lines and drugs, and which represent molecular signatures of resistance and sensitivity. And then we, based on these, we compute sensitivity scores and resistance scores for each drug cell line pair. And amazingly, when we do that, what we see here is, for example, we compute two scores, sensitivity scores and resistance scores. Those are the predicted scores in a leave-one-out cross-validation setting, and the color represents the actual IC50 value. The predictions map out the colors in such a good way in terms of the corroboration with the actual values, and also if we validate this on a different data set, we see a similar trend. And I think, you know, I don't need to go over my conclusion, and I would like to thank everybody who have contributed here and NIH for supporting this work, and we will appreciate your feedback on the project. Thank you.